As you can see, some videos call for shortness, quickness, and bruntness, to the point, straight for a shit shot, or a shit shot, and others might be elongated. So here we have it. We're still on the subject of this man falling on a thief, or falling underneath a thief. You know, you gotta figure, what's the verb it say here? It says he fell among thieves, man. So, you know, that kind of lets us know that the thief might have set a trap, right? The thief's like, ah, there he is. He's walking up the side of the mountain. I'm going to hide behind this rock. I'm going to set a string up right here and hide it under the dirt of the pathway. So when he walks by, I'm going to pull it up like that cartoon character, the wolf trying to catch the roadrunner. And watch him trip over it so he'll fall on the ground and I can pounce upon him. Now you notice that the thieves here is in the plural stage. So that lets us know there was at least more than one man there. Two or three against one. They took down the overpower and then they stripped. Well, then when we look at the rest of the verbiage, let's get some more context of what's going on here. Oh! So it looks like right here, they didn't strip themselves. They stripped the dude that they fell upon. Oh, my word, they stripped the dude. So what's that letting you know? Ah! What's that letting you know? You can go down all kinds of roads of thought on that. You can bring them all to the forefront, to the forefloat of the imagination of the thoughts, of all the thoughts that could be up there, or you could be like a tranquil yogi and you could escape those thoughts so that you don't have to examine them, and you can be away from it. From those thoughts and not have to deal with the true reality of the situation of existence in life, although it is nice to be able to pull oneself out of thought and be out of the body for a couple weeks at a time. That's all fine and dandy, but is it just an escape hatch so that one does not have to deal with the reality of his thoughts that are connected to his heart, that are being the thought or the brain is acting like a mirror that's reflecting the thoughts that are in the heart? And the heart is sending a message to the brain that says, yo, bro, you ever heard the knowledge of the sin? Yo, bro, did you ever know the perspective of the parables that our Creator, who presented these words here that are living? The heart is speaking, is reflecting to the brain. The brain is like a mirror. And if we were to sit here and survey all the thoughts that are in our in, identify them, categorize them, look at them, see their patterns, see how they interact from relationship to relationship, and we look for the underlying nitty-gritty that all these thoughts are alluding to a specific point. The point that all these thoughts are bringing creation to understand, or at least to be presented as a mirror, so that those who don't understand will at least have a record of why they weren't able to understand, that being that the Creator created them to never understand, so they won't understand. But for those who are able to get to the proper living understanding, those thoughts were all put into the brain as a reflective tape, so that a man could look back at the reflective tape, so that he could put together the pieces of the puzzles of life in such a way that when he is presented with a particular piece of the puzzle, and he fits that piece into place, that piece would be like a quick glimpse into the door that revealed a room that gave a sample of the reality of the situation that this life has to offer. And that reality is the knowledge of the Sam. And, you know, the brain is a part of the heart in a way that the brain is just a reflection of the heart. So that when we start getting into our thoughts and seeing what they really are, then it would reveal to us what's really going on in our hearts. And it reveals to us what really should be going on in our hearts when our Creator gives us a piece of the puzzle. It shows us the knowledge of the sin. It's not the knowledge of sin. It's the knowledge of the sin. And that represents one sin, one debt, one specific thing, just like in the reality of admiralty law, maritime law, law merchant law, that U.S. Federal Marshal, DOJ, Department of Justice attorneys are supposed to know and enforce on the little piddly attorneys that work underneath them that don't have the privileged knowledge. These Department of Justice attorneys, right? They understand that everything revolves around one specific thing. As it applies to the world of commerce. And the world of commerce is just a reflection of the knowledge of the sin, one specific sin, one specific debt. And when we are able to achieve certain yogi statuses to be able to leave our bodies so that we can relieve ourselves from the pressures of life or the pressures of the thoughts in the brain or to relieve ourselves from looking at our ugly ass in the mirror, we can say. When we look at the thoughts of our brain, it's as though our heart is being put in the mirror and we're able to see our shitty selves for who we really are, if we are willing to look in the mirror and stand there and stare into it and allow what needs to be seen float to the surface. So that we can start to actually smell the realization of that is there. To identify the odor. What smells bad, stenchy, and rotten. What smells pleasant and beautiful. And some of us need to be able to leave the mind so that we can take a break from the pressure and the stress of having to deal with this mess of a world that we live in. And it's nice to be able to take a vacation in the brain and to be able to separate oneself from the body and float through the universe for a couple weeks. While our body just sits under a tree at peace for a while. It's very relieving, and it's very nurturing, and it's much needed. Because the intensity and the weight of looking at our thoughts and looking in the mirror, the brain, the thoughts that life has to present to us, can be very overwhelming and too much to handle and too hard to figure out. Until, like I said, Yeshua gives us a piece of the puzzle of life that we've been putting together. When Yeshua gives us a piece of the puzzle and that introduces us to the door, to the room. He opens the door so that we can see into the room quickly, and then the door closes, and we get a glimpse, and it causes our inner man to leap inside with the pleasant joy, a very pleasant joy, a very pleasant joy. A very pleasant joy. This has been Sabaguru. This has been Sabaguru. You know, notice I don't call myself, I am Sabaguru. This is Sabaguru. Because Sabaguru is just a public name, a public identity. This has been Sabaguru, Lean Assurance. Lean Assurance is the public name that I use. First name is Lean, last name is Assurance. And the type of name this public name is represented is a guru status name, and the particular field of guru that the public name that I hold in trust is associated with, that particular style of guru is the style of guru that I am initiating for the first time into this world called a Saba Guru. Right? It's not a sad guru. It's not represent my pup. The public figure that I hold is not representing a sad guru, a happy guru, a depressed guru, or an excited guru. The public guru name that I hold, in due course, under trusted lien, ready for levy, as I fancy fit. The type of guru that I hold and am initiating into this earth is called a Saba Guru, as in to sob in tears. Saba. Abba, Father, Saba, to cry into the public record the words that need to be put so that the ears and the eyes and the nostrils and all the senses of taste can get a load of the crap.